No health struggles facing Hawaii. Aharo Hawaii and our health centers are empowering the communities that they serve to help solve Hawaii's health problems from home.
Our mission is to innovate and support our medical providers in this fight. We need a healthy and safe Hawaii for all.
Getting vaccinated is the best way to protect our kupuna, keiki, and community from COVID-19. Join us. Get vaccinated and help protect Hawaii.
Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders Health is sponsored by Aharo Hawaii.
Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders face a number of challenges addressing their health care needs. We'll take a look at some of the health disparities and social challenges they face, not only as we navigate through the COVID-19 pandemic, but as we look to the future for solutions. Here to explain some of the challenges are panelists from Hawaii Island, Kimo Alameda, Chief Executive Director of the Bay Clinic. Molokai Community Health Center Chief Executive Officer Helen Kekalia, and Dr. Mei Okihiro, pediatrician and director of research at the Waianae Coast Comprehensive Health Center. We thank you all for being with us. Well, for our first question, tell us about the current state of health care in Hawaii and who is the most in need. Kimo.
Well, thank you, Gina, and this is a pleasure to be on. Yeah, so when we talk about health care, I guess the best way to measure it is through our health outcomes. And so if you look generally at the state of Hawaii, I mean, it's not a secret, we're the healthiest state in the United States. And that's because, we don't smoke as much, we have lower levels of obesity, we are very active. 80% through surveys show that, hey, most of us are active. We have a lifestyle that is, very diverse. So we're more accepting to diversity, and we live longer. And so generally speaking, we're pretty healthy. But when you look at, when you take that data and you look at specific groups, then you start to see what we refer to in the health field as health disparities. And there are a bunch, and unfortunately, Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders feel the brunt of that.
Sure. Now let's get into those a bit. What health disparities do the Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders face most often in Hawaii? Kimo, let's have you start on that.
Sure. Yeah. Well, first, if you just look at life expectancy, the average, is kind of brought up by Asian women. Asian women live in their 90s. And that's why when people say, hey, you're the healthiest state, you guys live the longest, it's like, well, you got some groups that are pulling up the average there. So some of those disparities are just straight out, it's just life expectancy. If you're a Native Hawaiian or a Native Pacific Islander, you're lucky if you reach your 60th birthday, what leads up to that are cardiovascular disease, cancer, substance abuse, stroke. Native Hawaiian and Pacific Islanders are 2 to 3 times more in these areas than our ethnically diverse neighbors. That's why, as a CEO of Bay Clinic, and Helen can speak to this too, from Molokai, as well as Mei, who's done research on Native Hawaiians and our health disparities. We can tell you that, although we're the healthiest state, sometimes that kind of puts a mask on the fact that, shucks, hey, we got to pay attention to when you break up the ethnic groups, geographically even. Molokai, Lanai, Hana, right? Kau. So we get geographic disparities as well. And that's what we do as health centers. We pay attention to those groups. But I don't know. Helen, what's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, no, you really said it, Kimo. And specifically on aging. But you hit the big buckets of cardiovascular disease, diabetes, cancer, substance abuse, aging. But I've been looking and paying attention to the life expectancy rate. And when you start breaking down what's going on, as Kimo mentioned, geographically within our state and who's most impacted, where we're seeing those disparities the most. Again, if you're looking at it by zip code, you can see that it's the counties in Hawaii that have the most non-white residents, where we have a major disparity in age that falls lower than the United States. So namely, if you do go to, and actually this information is available on the CDC, but examine variations in life expectancy by zip code. Hawaii's zip code that has the lowest life expectancy is 96729. That is Ho'olehua Molokai. Shortly behind it, so Ho'olehua has an average lifespan of up to age 72 years. So that's pretty significant. That's one of the lowest that's marked geographically within the state. Shortly behind that is West Oahu, as well as areas of the North Shore Oahu. And then behind that, of course, is Hanamaui, very similar in community to Molokai. And then where Kimo's from, Hilo. So, you know, those are, I think, a big health indicator to be looking at when it comes to taking into consideration how environmental, political, socioeconomic, and other structural conditions impact health at the end of the day.
Boy, you sure can't argue with that data. Thank you. Now, how has COVID impacted Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders? Dr. Okihiro.
The pandemic has had a really profound effect on Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders in Hawaii and really across the nation, with some of the highest rates of infection, hospitalization, and death rates when compared with other ethnicities. In Hawaii, the first several months of the pandemic, it was our Pacific Island community members, especially those from the Marshall Islands, the Federated States of Micronesia, and Samoa, who were severely impacted. So for months last year, while they only represent 4% of the population, Pacific Islanders made up 20% or more of the infections. Over the last several months, especially with the influx of the Delta variant, infections and hospitalizations and deaths from COVID among Native Hawaiians has unfortunately skyrocketed. And so I just looked at the latest data from the Department of Health, and while 21% of our population are Native Hawaiians, they make up 30% of the infections currently. I also wanted to point out that COVID has had a profound effect on not just our health, but all those other things that are impacted. So our physical health, but also our mental health. We know that substance abuse has risen, depression, anxiety. We know that for many of going through the pandemic, it's been hard to eat healthy and to exercise. So we know that definitely from kids to adults, obesity and prediabetes rates have gone up. And so I think many of us realize that the pandemic, even once the infections go way, way down, that we're going to be dealing with this for a long time.
That's for sure. And Dr. Okihiro, let's stick with you to explore more about why Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders are underrepresented in the vaccinated population. Doctor?
So we know that vaccination is going to be one of the key tickets to get us beyond this pandemic. While they might not totally prevent infection, they definitely prime our immune system so that if we are infected, our chance of being hospitalized or dying from the infection goes way down. And so it's going to be really a key tool that all of us use. A lot of Native Hawaiians are actually fully vaccinated. Thousands of Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders have successfully gotten fully vaccinated against COVID-19. And I just want to emphasize that, because sometimes I think we only focus on the negative. But we do know that there are pockets across the state in many Native Hawaiian Pacific Island communities where vaccination rates are still low, too low to prevent another surge and more illness. I'm one of the researchers for the study called Pacific Alliance Against COVID-19, which is an NIH-funded project which has involved all of the Aharo community health centers. And we researched more than 2,000 participants and found that for those participants who used official sources of COVID information from the CDC, Department of Health, those kinds of sources, they were more likely to be vaccinated. But for those participants who use mostly unofficial sources of information, like social media, they were less likely to get vaccinated. And it kind of makes sense. So I think it's on us to really have accessible information available to all our community members.
We're going to come back to that topic very soon. We have a pause now for a short break, and we will be back in a moment with more questions.
Since the pandemic, there are new health struggles facing Kauai. Aharo Hawaii and our health centers are empowering the communities that they serve to help solve Hawaii's health problems from home.
Our mission is to innovate and support our medical providers in this fight. We need a healthy and safe Hawaii for all.
Getting vaccinated is the best way to protect our kupuna, keiki, and community from COVID-19. Join us. Get vaccinated and help protect Hawaii.
Welcome back. Before the break, we were talking about vaccination. We want to stay on that topic. How do we educate people on the risk versus the benefit of vaccination? Dr. Okihiro.
I think that people don't necessarily want to be lectured about vaccinations. They've heard a lot of talk. I do think it's really important that we listen to people's concerns about COVID and the vaccinations. So we're encouraging all of our healthcare providers and health educators to do this, to just listen, and then provide information that's easy to understand. I also just wanted to add that all of us want to be in control of our health and wellness, and that it's hard, and that some may think that refusing vaccination may be one way to do this, to keep that control of what's going into our bodies. But the reality of COVID is that it's really hard to not get infected. So many of us wear our masks most of the time, but maybe your child doesn't, or maybe your mask came loose just as you were passing by someone who started coughing. That virus can stay in the air for a long time, and then your control is gone. And so vaccination, it really is an essential layer of protection for all of us to give us back that control of our health.
Thank you. Now, what are some resources available that people may not know about that can really help Hawaii's Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders? Kimo.
Well, thank you, Gina. And thanks, May, for that. I wanted to kind of go back to May's point. I mean, it's so critical that it is true. I mean, vaccinations can help us. And when you look at the history of our Hawaiian history, you know, we, because of these diseases, if you will, I mean, we had a reduction in our population, a little bit over 90%. That's just crazy. I mean, tuberculosis, measles, syphilis, smallpox. I mean, just take smallpox, for example. I mean, if it wasn't mandated in 1854, and then again in 1890 by Queen Emma, I mean, you know, we would be in really bad shape as a population. So yeah, I know, you know, we don't like lecture. We might be past the lecture stage. But then again, you know, we have 85,000 cases currently, over 1,000 deaths. So, you know, I think it's true that the data can speak for itself. And so there is resources out there. There's researchers out there like Dr. Okihiro, and who's publishing these findings on how to reach our people. And there's our typical Native Hawaiian agencies, Alulike, QLCC, the Association of the Hawaiian Civic Clubs, OHA. And then there's Papa Ololokahi, right? Papa Ololokahi is kind of our go-to Native Hawaiian agencies, even as health centers, we look to them. So on Hawaii Island, you know, Hui Malama, Olana Oiwi, we partner with them. That's a great resource for Native Hawaiians. Of course, all of our federal qualified health centers, we have 14 across the state. You know, we, five of us belong to this awesome group called Aharo, which we'll talk about a little bit later, Waimanalo Community Health Center, Waianae Coast, Molokai, Big Island, Hamakua. And so, you know, we're also a resource. Please use us. But the best resource, I think, is this website. I got to direct you guys' attention to. This is the Native Hawaiian and Pacific Islander Hawaii COVID-19 response. It's along with response, recovery, and resiliency website. And it's actually, you know, funded for the long term. And we have some co-leaders. I mentioned Papa Ololokahi, Dr. Sherry Daniels. She's a part of this co-led group that puts great information on the website. Dr. Keawe Kahulukula, chair from the Native Hawaiian Health Department at JABSOM. And then we have our Pacific friends, Faletau, who's a co-founder for Pacifica Empowerment and Advancement, and then Josie Howard, who's the program director for Oceania. So these groups, these four leaders, if you will, come together, bring resources together, partner, and they publish this great website. So I encourage all of us to take a look at it. It has videos, and it's a great resource for our Native Hawaiian people.
Now, the White House just recently created White House Initiative on Asian Americans, Native Hawaiians, and Pacific Islanders. The purpose, to advance equity, justice, and opportunity for Asian Americans and Native Hawaiian and Pacific Island communities. So how does this initiative help Hawaii residents, Kimo?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you, Gina. That's a great question. And it's relatively new legislation. And so kind of like hats off to our senators, Brian Schatz and Mazie Hirono. Hats off to our representatives, Ed Case and Kai Kahele. I mean, you guys are really working hard for us. And we see it because it's a trickle down. And we see that funding coming to us that we could utilize for our people. So thank you so much, first of all. But this legislation essentially sets national policy. And it's headed up by our own Crystal Kai. She helped us with our conference as well. She's great. She's the executive director of the Congressional Asian and Pacific American Caucus, which kind of leads this effort. The goals of this legislation is to address several areas, hate crimes, right? Poverty and environmental justice, I'd say barriers to the entry in federal programs, improve data collection, expand language access. So this legislation is key for us. And, you know, we've had legislation in the past, but we have to continue zeroing in on these health disparities. I think Helen hit the nail right on the head. It's pretty sad when your zip code is a better predictor of your health outcome than your genetic code. And the health choices that we make really depend on the health choices that we have. And not every community has the same health choices.
Thank you. Now, recently, the federal government set aside federal money to cover 100% of Medicaid costs for all Native Hawaiian and Pacific Islanders. So how can the state of Hawaii best use this savings to improve Native Hawaiian and Pacific Islander health care in the future? Helen?
Great. Yeah, great question. I'm glad you're bringing this to light for discussion. And similar to what Kimo shared, just hats off to our representatives. This is another clear demonstration from our Hawaii representatives of them really representing the people and the needs here in our communities. So FMAP is what it's commonly referred to as. It stands for Federal Medical Assistance Percentage. A temporary increase to 100% was made and enacted on March 11th, 2021. And this is for the state's Medicaid and Children's Health Insurance Program, or CHIP, expenditures. Specifically, what is probably most important to mention is the further designation of these funds from our congressional delegates to specifically serve the Native Hawaiian population, and namely through Papa Ololokahi on behalf of the five Native Hawaiian health centers in the state. As well as any other deemed Native Hawaiian entity working in collaboration with Papa Ololokahi to further the mission and service of the Native Hawaiian people as it relates to health. So this is a big deal. And again, I just want to reference that it's temporary. When we're looking at the situation that we're in now and the pandemic and how do we come out of the pandemic, these disparities with our people existed before. They've now been further exacerbated by the pandemic. I think this is an excellent opportunity for the state to work collaboratively with the health resources that are here on the ground level serving these populations. One way that the state could probably look to using these funds is to reinvest them back into programs that serve and support the health needs of the Native Hawaiian health population. So this is primary care, but maybe a very underserved area that doesn't get enough airtime for any of us is adult dental. So we all know that our kiddos, our keiki, will get covered 100% by Medicaid. But if you're an adult, really you're getting extractions only. So this has been an ongoing continued disparity within our own state, and we're really getting the appropriate resources allocated. There is some wiggle room to be able to collaborate with entities like Papa'ololokahi. So Ahuro Hawaii has really embraced, I think, the notion of collaboration. We've done it together as CHC partners over a decade. And now we've really expanded that collaboration to include Papa'ololokahi. And primarily, this is all because of the populations we serve. We all live in those areas, those zip codes, as I mentioned, that are very high Native Hawaiian population. Over half of our patient population is Native Hawaiian, true for, again, Waianae, true for Waimanalo, as well as for Bay Clinic. So we've been able to work collaboratively with Dr. Sherry Daniels at Papa'ololokahi to develop a cultural as well as a healthcare-focused framework to address these disparities with the five health centers, while still meeting the mission and the spirit and intent of the FMAP. When we really take this to ground level of how these monies can be put to use with our people, clinical as well as social determinants of health become really the holy grail of how to treat one's total health status. So in public health, really these funds should be reinvested or could be reinvested into and integrated into the Medicaid and managed care program through contracts with our existing state Medicaid health plans. From a community perspective, again, referencing Papa'ololokahi and the work that they did with their landmark comprehensive study, the Eolamau study, that really focused on Native Hawaiian disparities, is using that as a framework and reinvesting those Medicaid dollars to address health disparities, including new initiatives that would address early onset of chronic diseases, such as diabetes, in our population. Substance abuse or substance use, it is a chronic disease. So we don't treat it as such, we don't fund it as such, but the amount of damage when one has substance use disorder to the prefrontal cortex of the brain is pretty significant. It doesn't happen acutely, it happens over time. The treatment takes time. So I think that's another area that we need to kind of start looking at funding it as long-term chronic illness and treating it as such.
Yes, so many worthy causes there that can get this windfall of funding. That is fantastic. You know, and the next question I think still relates to that. Let's keep that dialogue going. You know, what role do the community health centers play in supporting and advocating for health care needs of Hawaii's underserved, or even where this money is going to get directed? So specific to the role of the community health centers, Helen, let's have you start on that, and Kimo, if you want to add something to that, and then we'll move to our final question.
Community health is really important for public health. It's important for providing long-term sustainable solutions to the challenges that we're facing today, many of which have been ongoing for years, so and decades even, and have been heightened due to the pandemic. In basic terms, you know, community health centers as a business model provide comprehensive preventative care, and we help patients to monitor their chronic health conditions, including addressing those social and economic determinants that cause and or exacerbate one's health status. So ultimately, it serves to lower medical costs by reducing expensive emergency department visits and hospital stays. So from a business model perspective, it's not just the right thing to do for patients, but it's the most economic way to do it.
And Kimo, do you see the same impact over there on your side over in Hilo?
Yeah, for sure. You know, I don't know if everybody know the difference between like private practice healthcare and rural health clinic and federal qualified health center. So let me just tell you, the federal qualified health centers, like I said, get 14 in the state. Hey, we are super unique. There's rural health clinics too, but they don't have the mission and mandate that we get. So our mission and mandate is, hey, we got to serve everybody regardless of their ability to pay. So we provide comprehensive care, not just healthcare, because we know that, hey, if you're going to be healthy, you got to also look at your mental health. You also got to look at how, if you're eating right, or you got to look at your diet. And so you got to look at you know, your social support. So community health centers provide all of that in one place.
It is amazing.
And that's what makes us awesome.
It is amazing what they can do. Now, in closing and briefly, recently several of you were involved in the Ahuro conference. Journey back to our island healthcare home. What was your main takeaway from that conference in closing? Dr. Okihiro, we'll start with you.
I think the main takeaway is that we are all dealing with very similar problems. We may have unique aspects in each of our communities, but the more we can share about our strategies, the more we can build upon solutions, the better off for all of our community members.
Well said. Helen, your closing thought as it relates to those lessons from the conference.
Sure. So we had 25 community health centers, both from Hawaii as well as the U.S., represented. Nearly half of those in attendance were our community-based and majority consumer board members. So I want to just highlight that and thank all of those community members who are volunteers and are the soul of the work that we do. The message I walked away with is really the deep-seated need to move towards greater collaboration and consolidations in our system. I think that's no surprise to say that healthcare system is a very complex system that oftentimes does not necessarily serve the individual at the end of the day. And we need to, coming out of this pandemic, I think, really take a hard look at our resources and put aside, you know, differences and really come together to work in, I think, smarter ways, more strategic ways, ways that utilize our resources to better serve the greater whole.
Yes, thank you. And Kimo, your closing thoughts on that.
Yeah, sure. You know what I realize is from this conference, and I've been to many, is that we're all trying to do the right thing. I mean, we got a lot of Native Hawaiian agencies, JABSOM, for example, Papa, even the Hawaiian homesteads. I mean, we're all trying to create a healthier Hawaii, but we cannot create a healthier Hawaii without healthier Hawaiians. Okay, so, and as Martin Luther King said, hey, maybe we came in different ships, but you know what? We're all in the same boat. So let's continue to work together, and I think we can. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And that's all we have time for tonight. We thank you, our panelists, for participating, sharing your knowledge and your expertise from Hawaii Island, Kimo Alameda, Chief Executive Officer at the Bay Clinic, Molokai Community Health Center, Chief Executive Officer Helen Kekalia, and Dr. Mei Okihiro, Pediatrician and Director of Research at the Waianae Coast Comprehensive Health Center. And time now for a quick message from our sponsor.
Well, aloha, everybody. I hope you enjoyed those presentations. I do want to tell you a little bit more about AHARO. I'm Rich Bettini from Waianae Comprehensive. I'm the current chair of the AHARO board. So AHARO is really about some basic principles in healthcare. As we look at the needs of our community, it's incredibly important that we engage community in the process, that we're accountable to both community and those that fund us. And so engaging board members and volunteers and community leaders in the activities that we provide is essential. We're also very concerned about workforce and economic development and making sure that we train our own, that we're a resource for jobs, and we address the shortage in primary care resources. Cultural proficiency is absolutely essential. We work through Kapuna Council to make sure that we work within the values of our community. And finally, care enabling services, which are those services that we're developing that systematically reduce access to primary care services. I wonder if you'd come with me over here. I'm going to show you the garden. So I just want to say, in our garden, the five health centers planted 3 years ago small ulu trees. And as you can see, AHARO Hawaii is growing. Aloha.
And thank you so much again to our sponsor. And thank you at home for watching. Mahalo and good night.
Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders Health was sponsored by AHARO Hawaii.
USAA is made for the safe pilots. For Mac, who can come to a stop with barely a bottle. Lucia, who announces her intentions even if no one's there. And Sergeant Moore, who leaves room for her room. With USAA Safe Pilot, when you drive safe, you can save up to 30% on your auto insurance. Get a quote and start saving. USAA. What you're made of, we're made for.
I could be your secret Santa.
When I win,
you could win.
Our Secret Santas are giving away magical Disney vacations and gift cards, plus holiday cash to lucky wheel watchers.
And you could be next. Have your spin ID ready.
Our Wheel of Fortune Secret Santa holiday giveaway continues now.
Wheel of Fortune!
Ladies and gentlemen, here are the stars of our show, Pat Sajak and Vanna White.
Three victims over there. Thank you, Jim. Thank you very much. We appreciate that. Happy holidays. Hi, good to see y'all. All right, stop clapping and grab those devices. Here we go. Our first toss-up of the night. It's worth $1,000, and the category is person. And it's Gil.
Santa's little helper.
That is correct, yes. Gil Mellis won $1,000. Nice going. Diamond Bar, California. You are retired. What do you retire from, if I may ask?
35 years with the Defense Department as an auditor.
Okay. Let's talk about your family a little bit.
Well, I've been married 42 years to my best ever friend, Sue. We just recently celebrated it. I have two grown daughters and two wonderful grandsons.
It's good to have you here, and hope you win a lot more money.
Thank you,
Pat. You too, Rihanna.
Thank you.
Rihanna Aaron is from North Little Rock, Arkansas. And your cup of tea in the Disney world is what?
Yes, I am a huge Black Panther fan.
Yeah, okay. And you want to mention nieces and nephews?
Yes,
right?
I have three beautiful nieces, Maya, Simone, and Naomi. And I also have one nephew, Amari.
Good luck to you as
Thank
well.
Thank you.
Hi, Megan.
Hi.
Megan Cortez, right?
Yep.
From Huntington Beach, California, an employee benefits broker, it says on my card.
Yes.
Is that accurate?
That is accurate.
Uh-huh. And you're married?
I am married. I'm married to my amazing husband, Vidal. We've been married 6 years.
Yeah.
And I have two wonderful daughters, Amelia, who's 4, and Olivia, who's 1.
Good luck to all of you. Grab those devices again. We're going to give away some more money in our second toss-up. In the kitchen, the category, $2,000 at stake. Here we go. Gil.
Digital air fryer.
Yeah, that's it. With all that travel you do, I was afraid you were going to say flyer. And then you're a little bit in trouble there. Hey, Jim.
Hey, Pat. It's time to go, isn't it? That's
well,
my
wait,
cue.
Wait.
Yep,
let me really introduce you properly.
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, Jim Thornton.
I got to wait for the intro. Thank you for that, Pat. Here's tonight's featured Disney vacation. Get ready to experience the world's most magical celebration, the 50th anniversary of Walt Disney World Resort. Enjoy new experiences like Disney Enchantment, the beauty of Harmonious, and classic favorites. It's a celebration 50 years in the making, and the magic is calling you. $8,732, Pat.
Are you through? I guess so.